is Jack Bannister.
Thank you, Tony, and amen to all that was said. There's been none better.
As England's new cricket captain, the 25-year-old Lancashire batsman will lead England for the remaining two tests against Australia. Atherton succeeds Graham Gooch, who resigned on Monday after England's third defeat by Australia in the current test series.
Michael Atherton had meant to spend today walking in the Lake District. Instead, he found himself walking into one of the toughest jobs in British sport, captaining an England side which had been humiliated by the Australians just 2 days ago for the third time this season. Atherton's personal performance in that match displayed many of the qualities that have made him Graham Gooch's successor: great determination and the ability to act coolly under immense pressure. Characteristics expanded on by the chairman of selectors when he revealed five candidates had been considered.
The committee's agreed criteria included the need for mental toughness, especially with the West Indies in mind.
Atherton has been appointed for the last two matches of the Lost Ashes series with the expectation that he'll lead the tour party to the West Indies this winter. He's under no illusions as to the job facing him.
Well, Graham's carried the can for the team performances not being especially good, but I think all the players would be aware that it's their responsibility to produce the goods on the field. If we can get to the stage where they're producing their best, and if England play to their potential, then it's a realistic possibility to win games.
Over the years, too many New England captains have been ushered in with promises of a new dawn that never materialised. At only 25, Mike Atherton is a refreshing, imaginative choice, but the team under his command is patently a poor one, and expecting too much too soon would be foolhardy. Kevin Geary, BBC News, Lords.
Meanwhile, cricket is our game here on BBC Two on the day Mike Atherton first put his captain's shoes to the test at Edgbaston. Richie Benno has been watching the early progress of the fifth test.
Of a new era in English cricket. It's day one of Michael Atherton's reign as captain. The Australians have retained the Ashes, they've won the series, and they've also played wonderfully well throughout. History, I can tell you, is against England winning this fifth Cornhill Test match at Edgbaston. All seven England captains prior to Atherton lost their first match as captain. Well, it's a tough time ahead for England, but there's a lot of pride at stake for both teams and the two captains. Here they are now at the toss with Tony Lewis.
Morning, lads. Morning, Mike. Congratulations. Morning. Won the toss.
Thank you.
What are we doing?
We're batting. It looks a reasonable wicket, so I'll have a first use of it.
Can I talk to Alan quickly about the wicket? We've gone on several pitches now, haven't we? And you've always said, well, it looks a good wicket to me, mate. And they always have been. What does this look like?
Well, it's exactly the same. I'm a little bit surprised how dry the wicket is. But, you know, we just play the conditions and we're the visitors here, so we just, you know, go with whatever's put to us. But, yeah, just a bit surprised by the dryness of the surface.
Yeah. How about your team, Tim May? Is he fit?
Yes, he's, well, pretty close to it. And the way the wicket looked, you know, he basically had to play. So he'll get plenty of bowling, I think.
Mike, about the England team, you called a few in at the last moment. How's it resolved?
Well, Alex's fit, and we've left out Steve Watkin and Devon Malcolm.
Right. OK, good luck to both of you.
Thank you.
And just confirmation of the two teams for this fifth Cornhill Test match at Edgbaston. England skippered by Atherton, Stewart the wicketkeeper and vice-captain, and they have in the side John Embury, Peter Such is back in, and the Australians, they've decided to play Tim May, even though he is carrying a hamstring injury, and they'll be very hopeful he will get through okay. The umpires for this match, John Hampshire and David Shepherd, and confirmation also that England won the toss and will bat. We join play with the first ball of the match. Merv Hughes is the bowler. Graham Gooch is taking strike.
That's a good ball to start with. Graham Buchanan's feet not really moving there, just a very slight step forward, and you saw the extra stride after the ball had gone.
It's well followed by Rifle, but also well played by Atherton. Kept that angled nicely and ran it away all along the ground, way down to third man. Five for no wicket, four to Atherton, and the other one was a no ball. Now then, perhaps a yard quicker from Merv Hughes. His first ball at the New England captain.
You see, Richie, you'd have been on the back foot waiting for that and hooked it before, wouldn't you?
Beaten the man at point. Good indication of the pace of the outfield. The outfield is quite fast. Hughes has taken three from that. Shane Warne was the man doing the chasing.
That was a good delivery, and you saw there drawing Atherton into a walking shot. The right foot came past his left there, turned him round.
And he's gone. Graham Gooch has gone, and once again, Paul Rifle has got the ball in the right spot. Gooch had to play at it. It swung away. Rifle's been a little wayward so far this morning, but this over, a little bit more on the mark.
That was a long way from his body there, Gooch, and pushing at it. It was a good outswinger. He got the ball to go nicely, but I think when Graham watches that on television, the replay, he'll be a little bit disappointed having played at that delivery. But certainly plenty of swing there for Rifle. He can get the ball in the right place. He will pose problems for the England batsman.
Robin Smith is a new batsman. First wicket down for England, having won the toss here at Edgbaston. But wore a second slip. It's a question of whether or not it carried. That was very low as well.
Good delivery again from Paul Rifle, getting the ball for her, swinging away again. Smith driving through it. Just dropping short between the slips.
And runs, and certainly two and maybe three. Rare fielding error, but mid-off was wide. Slater. Nicely played by Atherton. Shane Warne in the covers.
Well, that really was a flashing drive by Robin Smith. It was wide, he went after it. Great stop.
Oh, lovely shot. Cream that. Second boundary of the morning, both of them to the England captain.
Top class off drive.
That's a better ball, the result's the same. Much swung perhaps as just a little bit of movement off the seam.
this is where, as a batsman, you've got to be careful. An inside edge here from a fairly innocuous delivery, short of a length.
Robin Smith at his best. His first boundary. In such a positive mood. He's slightly short of a length, outside off stump, and bang.
The 50 comes up with the most solid shot from Michael Atherton. That's a good chase, but all in vain. Really firm clip, straight down the road. Have we seen Robin Smith play that shot? It's getting quite difficult to describe now. It looks so automatic, and yet it's quite an outstanding shot.
Yes, it's probably his best shot, the square cut. He really does hit it hard. Anything just short of the length, and he's very quickly onto it.
64 for one, England batting first. Here, Edgbaston. Cracking shot. It's one that Mark Ward dug in and actually stood up to be hit. And the 50 partnership.
Yes, the thing Mark Ward did wrong here, he got the length and the height right, but didn't get the direction right. He gave Atherton plenty of room.
Oh, that's close. Mike Atherton put his hands out as if he suggested he might have had a touch or going on leg side, but it was quite a confident appeal.
Yeah, it just held from leg side, didn't keep on angling down. I think I felt there's just that bit of doubt of whether it would have hit him or not. It wasn't a long way forward.
Well, that's very, very good. It's beautifully bowled by Mark Waugh. He's darted that back off the seam to Robin Smith. Might just have been an inside edge. Difficult to tell from exactly where we are, but Robin Smith has gone for 21. Now you could see some spin of the new man coming in, Matthew Maynard, and Mark Waugh has achieved the breakthrough there with the score on 71.
Yeah, Mark Waugh has bowled at a pretty lively pace this morning, and I think that just really angled in. It didn't do a great deal, and I think Robin Smith will be disappointed having missed that. I mean, I think more than anything, he probably did him on pace.
Well, it looked as though it came between bat and pad. It was a very good delivery. It started back a long way. Hit the top of, well, just about the top of off, I'd say. It's well bowled by Mark Waugh. He's done precisely the job Alan Border wanted. Get the breakthrough, bring in the new batsman. Maynard about to face his first ball on a return to Test cricket. Mark Waugh is the bowler. Good delivery. Good shot. Straight down the ground. That's a chase for Tim May. Even fully fit, he wouldn't have cut that off. It's going to be Tim May now, bowling off spin. Maynard is taking straight. The answer to the question of will the ball turn was decidedly so. Bibor. Yes, he's gone. Maynard has gone. That's brilliantly caught. A splendid catch by Steve Waugh. And Tim May has struck in the first over. He's bowled. Maynard had his back to us here, so the replay may show if it was inside edge onto pad and then away out to silly point, or if it hit the pad first and then the edge of the bat. There's definitely some turn there.
It was a brilliant catch by Steve Waugh. It was very low, it went quickly, and he had to dive forward on it. Excellent catch. A terrific start for Tim May, but not much joy there for Matthew Maynard, out for a duck on recall.
76 for three now. Drama in this first session, and Alex Stewart is the man in. Great shot. That drifted away from the right-hander, but he followed it and really gave it some hammer.
And if you want to dominate the opposition attack, that's what you've got to do. When the loose ball comes along, you've got to put it away.
Good shot. Beautiful play by Stewart.
He's such a lovely timer of the ball, Alex Stewart, that all he's really got to do is make sure that he gets the ball into the gap, and most times it's going to go to the boundary.
And that's the lunchtime score, 93 for 3, Gooch out for 8, Smith for 21, and Maynard without scoring, 43 to Atherton, and 12 to Alex Stewart. The pitch definitely taking some spin, as indicated by Tim May's figures, 3 overs, 2 maidens, 1 for 5. We join play after the luncheon interval, 1 run has been added, and Tim May is the bowler, bowling to Alex Stewart.
Vicious in one way, but if no shot was played and the bat was held back, then every reason to shout.
Yes, this ball went through and hit him on the back leg. If you watch it, look, that hit him on the back leg. Now, if he's hiding the bat behind the pad, then he's not really trying to play at the ball.
That's a lovely shot. He's one of the best timers in English cricket. That's 4 runs. Brings up the 100. Wasn't playing it there, but it's 4.
Well, that was beautifully bowled. Full credit to the bowler. Lovely flighted, drifted away from Mike Lafton, tempted him to drive.
There's his 50. Not without its problems, but captain's knock indeed. 106 for 3, Atherton 50. 14-50 for England. Lovely shot. That's glorious.
Thick outside edge, but that's flown away. It really raced away down to third man. All contributions gratefully received. 4 more to Michael Atherton.
Got the feeling that that was pretty well intentional, that shot. I think Atherton maybe not trying to get it quite as fine as that. Perhaps behind point, away past Shane Warne's left hand.
4 runs. It's such a slow pitch. If it's dropped short, there's plenty of time to get into position.
That's where the England batsmen have been picking off Warne throughout this series, the short ball. Either been using the pull shot or the cut shot through the offside.
Boundary in and went straight into the crowd.
Well, that's a nice offering for a batsman. There's no one at deep mid-wicket, so Alex Stewart doesn't have to bother about hitting it on the ground. And in fact, he's hit it so well that it carried into the crowd.
And just for the moment, Shane Warne has lost it. Not to say he wouldn't come back rather quickly, but it's this sort of domination with a bat that England have badly needed throughout the series.
Well, it was well played and well fielded also. Wasn't a bad ball from Shane Warne, but Stewart was down the track driving beautifully.
Good cricket, good length delivery, about off stump, spinning, Stewart using his feet and good fielding.
Got him. That's good bowling. Leading edge. Batsman will think, well, perhaps all slowed up from the pitch. But that's good deceit from Shane Warne. Took a hammering from Stewart and he's come back and taken the wicket. Fourth one to go down.
I was just going to say it's a much better over, and I think the reason why it's a much better over is bowled it slower this over. And he certainly deceived Stewart there, trying to work it away, leading edge. I'm sure he bowled every delivery there slower than he tried to bowl it the over before. So once again, England get into a strong position, batsman gets going, then gets out. Mike Stewart would be disappointed. They'd done the hard work, got in, 45, and then out. And that's one of the reasons why England are in the position they've been this year.
Oh, wow. I think that kept a little low. How low, we won't know till we have a look at the replay, because we're watching with the naked eye from behind here. But the England skipper has gone for 72. Rifle has got through his defence with a ball that was appreciably quicker. Played very well, Michael Atherton. 72 for him in a total of 156 for 5.
It certainly gave the impression of keeping low. And it certainly did keep low. That was no more than 9 inches at the stumps. And completely beat Atherton in height there.
Yes, it was about, well, I suppose, halfway up the stumps, and it certainly was a bit quicker than anything else he's bowled in the last couple of overs. Now, if he was holding it back and then really gave it the bazooka treatment. Nothing low about it. Looked as though it beat him, got through his defence in a way that he couldn't understand. As Nasser Hussain stood there and kept the straight bat in front of him. Looked as though the picture, without words, was actually saying, how on earth did that get through? Now we'll show you.
Well, that was what you call a pretty good delivery. Pitched roundabout off, went a bit like a leg break, clipped the off, and you couldn't really grumble at being bowled by a ball like that.
Absolute Rosner. Oh! Well, that's bravery if ever I've seen it, not from John Hampshire, but from the batsman, to pat up to a ball that looked as though it finished up on the stumps.
Yes, I think probably the height of the delivery saved him there. That set off, pitching about, off stump, came back with a bit, probably about middle or so for line. Possibly the height just saved him, but it was very, very close.
Nice stroke. And it's gathering paces, goes across the outfield. The outfield's very fast, which makes for good cricket. Got it. may well have picked it also. Certainly as soon as it became short, he was in position for the pull stroke, and it was the top spinner, or the flipper, from Shane Warne.
First ball from Hughes at the city end, and it looks as though it's gone for four. Score to 179, Thorpe under 17. There's four runs.
Well, every time Shane Warne has pitched short, first Alec Stewart has smacked him over mid-wicket. And now the left-hander, Graham Thorpe, he's picking him off the short ball. Good cricket, sensible batting.
And Emery finds a way through. Technically a chance. It's four runs.
Well, I think that was catchable. Very definitely. I think if you watch closely, Mark Taylor slipped, sets off to move to his right. Sets off there. You know, it went quickly, but I think you'd expect to catch that.
Three more runs added to take the score along to 194 for six. Graham Thorpe on 26, and John Embury, the very experienced all-rounder, on 7. 194 for 6, and the bowling figures for the Australians. Riflehurst 3 for 61. That's a good performance from him. A wicket for Mark Waugh was very handy for Alan Border, and a wicket each to May and Warne. Well, Thorpe and Embury saw England pass the 200 mark after tea, and we join them now in the third over after the interval. Mark Waugh is the bowler, and Graham Thorpe, the left-hander, is taking strike.
Well, that's a cracking stroke. Really laid into that one and got it right off the big part of the bat. Good shot. And to get two for it as well. That's a good stand. Just at the right time, just when if the Australians had broken through, the day would have been a disaster for England, and Thorpe and Embury have added a half-century partnership. Nice placement by Embury. And pretty good timing too.
Yes, we talked about no batters for John Embury, but amazing, once he gets a chance to play an attacking shot, then suddenly Backley disappear. There's Shane Warne again short. You see the Backley then, no problem once he wants to play an attacking shot.
Oh, well, he's gone. Gone. Has to go. Nicely taken by Ian Healy. And well played by Graham Thorpe for his 37. Skipper will be disappointed he hasn't been able to go on with it. It has been a problem for England throughout this series.
Now Tim May tossing this a bit slower and wider. Well outside of stump. That was a foot and a half. Going for a drive. That's a good catch. We can't see whether the edge or not here, but certainly Ian Healy was very confident, and it was a good catch because it was a very full length and wide. But Graham Thorpe would be disappointed to get out to that delivery.
He gets a leg by there, I'm not sure how much he played at that. Let's hear from Ian Chappell.
I think he was definitely trying to play it. Ian Healy asked the question that pitched, well, conservatively 2 feet outside leg stump. But spun a long way. Martin Bicknell didn't have a clue where it was going.
Deceptive little shot. Everybody in the cover area was on the alert, but the thick outside edge brings John Embury 3 runs.
Actually, it was quite well played in the end, because I think Embury was going to have a real lash at it and try and slap it through cover point. Then at the last minute, I think he changed his mind, realised he'd been beaten in the flight, and just held back a little bit on the shot, but didn't carry far in the air.
There you go. Six runs over mid-wicket.
That's the good thing about Embury's batting. He might look as though he's totally intent on defence, but you give him something there that he thinks he can deal with, and he puts it away. Getting to it on the full, timed it nicely, and just managed to clear the rope.
Little short arm jab. This is the infuriating part of Embury as far as bowlers are concerned. You think he can't pull, and then he does a stroke like that. Takes him to 31 and the score to 236. See, no pickup still. But, strong wrists. Here's the shorter one, and this time off the middle, that's 4.
For me, he's been fairly innocuous today, as my views. The best bowler has been Paul Rifle.
And there's 2 or 3 more. Brings up the 250. That's the rate of progress. Worth 4. Takes him into double figures.
Every over, he looks as if he's going to get a wicket, Paul Rifle. An outside edge. Good luck for England. It went for 4 and for Martin Bicknell.
That is a beautiful delivery, because it might be just a touch wide, but Embury is covering the off stump.
Well, it's another one of those wicket-taking deliveries. Pitched, left the batsman. He's kept on doing that all day, as Paul Rifle. He's bowled well enough to get 5 wickets.
I don't think that was quite such a lucky shot as Hughes might think it was. He's probably playing it squarer, but there was enough of the uppercut in it.
Yeah, it's a little bit of luck here for John Embury. He's trying to hit it over the gully area. Gets a little bit more top edge onto it than he perhaps wanted, but he'll take it because it went for 4.
262. I played quite well.
It was indeed. Any batsman couldn't have played this better. Watches the ball, sways inside, and just at the last minute turns his head away. Beautifully played.
got him. Mark Waugh doesn't miss anything. And Martin Bicknell has got a good one from Paul Rifle. Rifle's got that outswinger going now. Made an enormous difference to his bowling. He's done wonderfully well, first of all at Headingley and now here again today. A fourth wicket for him, and that's how it happened.
Yes, that's typical of the many deliveries he's bowled today, Paul Rifle, and that's typical of where many have been played. Just pushing through it, that made the ball carry. Good low catch by Mark Waugh there. And well-deserved wicket by Paul Rifle. He's been Australia's best bowler today, there's no doubt about that.
Peter Such comes out to join John Embury. Oh, there's no doubt about that. It's a good five-wicket haul for Paul Rifle. An excellent spell of bowling from him to add to the ones he produced earlier in the day. He's come in the Headingley match, done precisely what has been wanted, and now he's picked up five here as well.
Well, it was a good delivery again, pretty similar to the one that got Sane out earlier in the day. Picks roundabout off, it off, and well, as a tail-end batsman, you can't grumble at being bowled with a delivery like that. And he's thoroughly deserved those figures, Paul Rifle, today, and you could tell he was very pleased, and the Australian players were very pleased for him as well.
Maybe might have got back to two there, but couldn't make it. Shane Warne has got round in time, but John Embury has a half century. That's a very good innings. It's 268 for nine.
Yes, and I'd like to add to that, the England captain's applauding him. He's in a splendid performance. And he really has fought, very gutsy.
Now it's Hughes to Islet. Well, they might get three there to give Embury the chance of the strike again. He's urging Islet on. Well, it's good cricket. Gentle urger of the ball, John Embury. No more runs at it after that John Embury boundary to take it along to 276 for nine. A good effort from Embury, 55 and unbeaten. Mark Islet stayed with him. Very valuable innings there at the end. Only made three, but it was good from England's point of view. Also a good partnership with Martin Bicknell. 72 for Michael Atherton at the top, and a good innings from Alex Stewart and another one from Graham Thorpe. The bowling figures for the Australians, 101 overs in the day, that is terrific. And Rifle, wonderful performance again. 22 overs, 3 maidens, 5 for 71. 2 wickets for May and a wicket each for Mark Waugh and for Shane Warne. Now here with their impressions of the day's play, Ian Chappell, and alongside him is Geoffrey Boycott.
Well, when you're given the job of captaincy, one of the first things to do is to play well. And that'll give Mike Atherton a lot of confidence. The fact that he played a very good innings and got a half century, that, I think, will give him a lot of confidence.
Yes, that will. I don't think it'll give him much confidence with the selections that the selectors left him with. Two of the new bowlers had to go home. They didn't play in the match. So you just, at times, don't know where the England selectors are going.
Now, you wonder about the long-term plan, and I think the other area that you would have to query is the balance. I'm not sure that they've got the balance of the side right throughout the whole series.
I'm not sure they know what they're doing. No left-arm spinner, just one off-spinner. And then when they had to send for a second spinner, that was an off-spinner, and it was a 40-year-old off-spinner, even though he batted beautifully. That's no long-term planning, and that's what worries me about English cricket. It's like playing snakes and ladders, up the ladders and down the snakes.
Yeah, John Embry, really, I think he showed a lot of the batsmen what can be done if you put your head down and you show a fair bit of determination. I thought it was a very, very good effort from John Embry.
Top class.
Ian Chappell and Geoffrey Boycott, and they've had a good day, so have I, because it's been wonderfully interesting cricket real topsy-turvy day, with England on top for a start, then Australia, and good fight backs by both sides all the way through the day. Wonderful effort from Paul Rifle, and I can tell you I'm looking forward to the second day just as much as I enjoyed the first. We'll be back on BBC Two at 10:55 a.m. And for the moment, from Edgbaston, it's goodbye.